Excellent.
And can you see the mouse?
Yeah, you can, we can see your pointer, but you, if you move it around too quickly, it won't track too quickly, and it's a little bit small, but you can still use it.
Okay.
All right, so we'll get started here. Hello, everyone, and welcome to phyloseminar.org, a project supported by the Society of Systematic Biologists. Today is the third talk in a mini-course of three talks on genome-scale phylogeny. First, we heard from Gergely Zolosi and Bastien Bousseau, and today from Eric Tannier. Eric has a long-term interest in problems relating to the evolution of genome organization. He came from his computer science background by considering the problem of sorting by reversals. After writing quite a few important papers on that subject from a technical viewpoint, he began investigating the biological implications of this work. He has also done important work on incorporating genome rearrangements into phylogenetic inference. Most recently, he has been collaborating with the other two speakers of this mini-course on large-scale gene tree species tree inference. Thanks for speaking, Eric, and I'm looking forward to your talk.
Thank you. So I am Eric Tannier, and my talk will be the following of Gergely's one and Bastien's one, but I will start from somewhere else about the evolution of genome organization, and then I will converge to the gene tree, species tree framework at the end of my talk. So the first thing I wanted to do is to come back to a historical problem when rearrangements have been discovered in the 20s and 30s of the 20th century. And before having been discovered, they were predicted by looking at linkage disequilibrium between markers. From the linkage disequilibrium, you could compute the distance between markers. From the distance, you could order the markers along chromosomes. But for two different strains, if you can see my pointer here, I'm looking at this part of the figure. For example, this is the arrangement of some markers on a strain, and this was the arrangement of the same markers on another strain of Drosophila. And the order of the markers are different between the two. They share some markers, but the linkage disequilibrium gave different distances, so that the order of the marker was different. And then, as it was different, and the difference was that B, C, D, E was inverted, Sturtevant in 1921 predicted that there was a mutation of this. At that time, it was an abstract object carrying genes, and there was a mutation of this object, and that mutation should be an inversion. And I think that was the very first mutation that was predicted on the hereditary material. At that time, they even believed that it was the only possible mutations. The point mutation were not known. And it was predicted that if you concatenated two chromosomes from two different strains, it would give some kind of loop like this. So they drew the loop. And later, this was a predicted loop, and later they observed this loop by really concatenating chromosomes from different Drosophila strains. So it's an example, it's a nice example of something that in biology was predicted before being observed. And once it was discovered, this mutation modeled and you can see here an article, a part of an article from 1937, again by Sturtevant and a student, giving the order, the relative order of some markers in Drosophila pseudo-obscura and Drosophila melanogaster. So these are the sequences for the five chromosomes of the Drosophila, and the melanogaster sequences are written here, L, H, F, E, B, etc. On the X chromosome, then on the other chromosomes, it gives that order. And on the pseudo-obscura, the order is the alphabetical order. So it's A, B, C, D, etc. And the numbers in parentheses, as it's written here in the following text, they represent the number of successive inversions necessary to turn the sequence that is written here into an alphabetical order. So let's, for example, take the second one, D, E, F, A, C, B, and they say you need two reversals to transform that into the alphabetical order. So you can try a little bit and pause the video, and if you want the solution, it's the following. First, reverse A, F, D, E. This gives this sequence, and then reversed from F to B, and you have the alphabetical order. So even that, with two events, it's easy to do it, but it's not so trivial. At first, it's not easy to find the solution. So now, let's try the X chromosome, where it's not two events, but seven events. In fact, they say seven, but in the text, if you read it, they say, in the case of chromosome X, we are not yet certain that six inversions may not be sufficient. Let's try to do that. So this is the arrangement of the X chromosome. What you would like to do is to put A at the beginning, for example. So put A at the beginning, and you have that, A, B. Now you would like that C follows B, so reverse that. So that C follows B, and then there is A, B, C, D at the beginning. There is A, B, C, D, but not yet E after the D, so reverse that to have the E just after the D. And then again, you need to put things together in the alphabetical order, so try that, to put the L just before the M. So you have to reverse that, and then it remains to do two inversions, one of GH, one of AG, and you have your scenario. And in fact, this scenario I show is six inversions long, whereas they said seven in the paper, but they said they were not sure that six wouldn't exist, and in fact it exists because of this this precise scenario that is shown here. And what I wanted to say by showing you this scenario of six, while they found only seven, is that reconstructing rearrangement scenarios is far from being trivial. Imagine you have to count substitutions in a genome. So you align two genomes, and if there were only six or seven substitutions, it's very easy to decide if there were six or seven. Just count the number of difference, and that's it. It's trivial. But if it's about inversions, it's not trivial at all, and you can be mistaken. You cannot find that at the first try if it's six or seven. So it's in the in algorithmic complexity, it's one order harder than counting substitutions, counting inversions. Continuing with the history things, reversals were still the only mutation known. But with this mutation, this only mutation known, already Dobzhansky and Sturtevant made molecular phylogenies with that. So here is an example of a molecular phylogeny from 1938, so long before the structure of the DNA was known and long before the substitutions were used to do molecular phylogenies, just by counting the loops. So the history of molecular phylogeny started long before the most popular models, but these models with substitutions and alignments eventually became the most popular. This is something Gergely already showed you. It's the old alignment by Ducker, Kandel, and Pauling in 1965. And so this is the alignment as it is in the paper of 1965. And this is the same alignment as it has been computed again recently by recent tools. And then they were doing phylogenies with substitutions. And finally, phylogenies with substitutions have been much more successful, although they were discovered much later, so they had much more time to do models with rearrangements than with substitutions. But models with substitutions are much more involved, much more successful, for several reasons. So for reasons are, for example, state space. State space, when you have a substitution and you work with DNA or with protein, the state spaces are 4 or 20, while the state spaces for rearrangements, inversions, as you saw, is the order of the number of permutations, so it's a much higher number. Available data also argue for using substitutions. There is a lot of available data where we can do phylogenies with substitutions, especially where the NGS data give short fragments. And with these short fragments, you can detect substitutions, but not rearrangements. You need to assemble, and many genomes are sequenced with NGS data are not assembled enough to study rearrangements. Algorithmic complexity is quite easy for substitutions and quite hard for rearrangements. So, of course, it depends on the problem. There are hard algorithmic problems for substitutions, but let's say the basic things, like if you compare two genomes, detect the number of substitutions or the number of rearrangements that have taken place, one is easy, one is hard. The tools, it's a consequence of the availability of data and the algorithmic complexity. There are many, many good available tools to do phylogeny with substitutions, but not with rearrangements. So there are some tools, but really it's much a fewer number of good tools. And also signal conservation. So this is more like an intuition I have, because I'm not so sure about that, but the rearrangements are considered as rare events compared to substitutions, but it's rare events on a space on much more sites than rearrangements, and I think that the signal conservation is much better in a genome if you evolve it by substitutions than if you evolve it by rearrangements. You can go to deeper history of life if you look at the substitutions. But I would like to argue that studying substitutions and local mutations instead of rearrangements and evolution of the organization of genomes is due to the availability of tools and the difficulty of algorithmic problems, but not the biological importance of these mutations. And I'll try to give a small argument on that, which is not, of course, a definitive argument, but it's a simulation. And it's an interesting simulation as with the EVOL, which means artificial evolution model, you can evolve genomes. These are circular genomes with genes by local mutations and by rearrangements. And genomes have a task to achieve, which mimics the adaptation to an environment. Here, the task is to approximate a function. This is the function to approximate, and with the genes, they try to approximate the function, which I will not detail how they approximate the function exactly, but it's just to say that they have a task to do. And you can change the task at a certain point. And if you change the task, it's like an environment change. And you do three experiments. One, you allow all kind of mutations. This is the black line here, local mutations and rearrangements. One, rearrangements only, one, local mutations only. And this graph is in the x-axis, you have the generation, how the genomes evolve. And in the y-axis, you have the distance to target. So it's a sort of the opposite of the fitness, in fact. And the lower it is, the better are the genomes to achieve their task. And you can see that if rearrangements are not allowed here, genomes follow this line going there, so adapting to the environment, but not as good as if rearrangements are allowed. But if local mutations are not allowed and only rearrangements are allowed, genomes adapt to their environment just as well as if both types of mutations are allowed, or almost as well. You see that there is a little difference here that is not really significant. So it's possible that rearrangements are very important for adaptations. When there is a huge environmental change, you need to construct new genes. You need to combine your genes to construct new ones. And to do that, it's possible that you need rearrangements and not only the point substitutions. But as I said, there is an algorithmic complexity problem to study the rearrangements. Now we know quite good algorithms to solve the problem I just showed you with the historical example, the problem of Sturtevant and Tann. We know how to solve it, at least for this kind of permutations that I called signed permutations, because numbers have signs, and they have signs just because the genes on the chromosome, they are not points in the chromosome, but they are segments on the chromosomes. And if they are segments, you can read them in one direction or in the other direction. So that makes two signs. And whether they are read on one direction or on the other, you put a plus or a minus sign and you have signed permutations. And of course, if you reverse a segment, every gene that is inside the segment is read in the other direction. So you flip the signs. So for example, you have an example here. If you reverse 7, 5, 3, -1, you reverse the order, flip the signs, and with four reversals in this precise case, you arrive at the identity permutation, which is an equivalent of the alphabetical order I showed you before. There are good algorithms to do that, but it's very difficult to generalize them. For example, we would like to be able to count the solutions, to, for example, sample them, integrate them. We would like to integrate more events also, because this, we know how to solve it, but in the case there is no duplications of gene, no fusions of gene, no fissions of gene, no combination. It's just if the gene content is fixed. And we know how to do it for two genomes, but for three and more, it becomes already hard. And this complexity results are really illustrated by this historical example I showed you. They were not able to find the right number when trying to minimize the number of inversions going from one permutation to another, because it's a difficult problem, and we are currently still facing this difficulty by the impossibility of integrating this rearrangement to other events and to scale up to handling many genomes. So there is the MCMC way. The MCMC way is not to care about the algorithmic complexity, just suppose that as soon as you can simulate the events, then you can construct an MCMC for the inference, navigating in the space of phylogenies for many genomes, in the space of ancestral configurations, in the space of scenarios, and then you navigate and have a sample at the end of what might have happened in evolution in terms of rearrangements. So there are some tries to do that. There is in particular Badger by Brett Largett in 2004 and 5. There is a nice application on the Yersinia genomes in 2008. And I have tried with István Miklós to prove also some theoretical results on the convergence of such MCMCs. Which was nice, but already for two genomes it was rather complicated, and if you want to add genomes you are limited to a few genes, like a few dozens of genes with a dozen of genomes, and still there is no MCMC framework that includes like duplications of genes, transfers of genes, and it goes beyond the possibilities of the current algorithms and computers. So we have to change, in order to study rearrangement, we have to change our way of handling that. And the change I would like to propose here, and that will meet the phylogenetic studies, is to consider genomes as sets of, not permutations, but sets of genes and adjacencies. Genes are the arcs that are showed in green in this figure, the oriented arcs. So genes are still oriented. They can be read in one direction or in the other. And adjacencies are just the link between two consecutive genes. So they are unoriented links. They just say this gene is followed on one genome by this gene. And if you just see a genome like that, you can code the presence of or absence of adjacencies by zeros and ones. For example, zero means an adjacency is not present. For example, an adjacency between this gene and that gene is not present in the genome, so it has value zero. And the adjacency between this gene and that gene is present in the genome, so it has value 1. So you can code like this a genome with zeros and ones for all the adjacencies, like this. Genome 0753-1-6-2-4-8 can be coded by a long sequence of 1s and 0. 1 is for 0 followed by 7. 0 followed by 7 is an adjacency, so I put 1 here. It's not in the end genome, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I put 0 on the sequence of the second genome. The first one that is common to the two genomes here means genomes starts with a zero, which can be seen as an adjacency between gene zero and a telomere. Let's say the telomere is a marker in the genome, so adjacency between zero and the telomere is conserved, one and one here between the two genomes. And then you can code your genome by a sequence of zeros and ones. The advantage of doing that is that you are back to a substitution model. You can assume that every site is evolving independently from the other, and doing phylogeny with a substitution model. From 0 to 1, it's the gain of an adjacency. From 1 to 0, it's the loss of an adjacency. But what does a rearrangement on this sequence? Look at an inversion. An inversion breaks two adjacencies, here and here. And an inversion builds two adjacencies from one between 0 and 1 here, between 6 and 7 there. So an inversion has an effect on four sites. So it's not true that the sites are independent, because when one moves, three other moves move also. But we can ask if we can do phylogeny with it, assuming that they are independent, and see what we lose. And to see that, I have another simulation. In this simulation, I take a genome with 100 markers, let's say 100 genes, and I simulate from 1 to 400 inversions on it. And I draw the graph of the real number of inversions and of the estimated number of inversions. So when there are a few inversions, you can follow the number of inversion, and then the signal saturates, because after 100 or 200 of reversals, you have completely randomized your permutations. You have no information on your arrival permutation, on what was your departure permutations, and then you cannot estimate the real number of inversions, because from 2000 to 3, from 200 to 300, it makes absolutely no difference between the two permutations. They are randomized anyway.
Oh, can I ask a quick question?
Yes, so I have my screen in front of me.
No, but it's okay. You don't have to change anything.
Questions, but of course, you can ask questions, yes.
So when you say the estimated number of inversions, is this estimated using these adjacencies?
No. For example, for the moment, it's the inversion distance.
I see. Okay. So if
what I call the inversion distance is the minimum number of inversions that are necessary to transform the start permutation into the arrival permutation.
Okay. So this sort of implies something about this adjacency distance, although it's not exactly.
Yeah, so my next slides are with doing that with adjacencies.
Okay. Sorry.
It's my two next slides, in fact, because. But don't hesitate to interrupt me, of course, if something is not clear.
Thank you.
first, so the line here was the parsimony solution, that is the minimum number of inversions necessary to explain the difference between the two permutations. It's possible to make a better estimation of this number of inversions by using probabilistic models. So by using probabilistic models, there is a correction. For example, here I use Badger, the software of Brett Largett that gives a good estimation of the number of inversions. And to my knowledge, it's the best software available for estimating this inversion, the real inversion distance. But when we switch to adjacencies, just the coding of adjacencies, and if we suppose, and I think that answers your question, that adjacencies evolve independently from each other, that's what we pay for it. So we estimate the number of differences. There is saturation happens much sooner than with the inversion distance. So the difference between these two curves is what we pay by doing this independence hypothesis on the adjacencies. If we suppose that adjacencies are independent, that's what we get. And if we suppose that they are not independent, that is computing the inversion distance, that's what we get. So it's much easier to compute this curve, the black curve, but it's not as good, not at all. And the explanation that it's not at all as good is that I showed you that I was coding the presence of absence of every adjacency. But this makes a lot of zeros in the sequence, because there are many adjacencies that you never observe. Let's get back to this. For example, in this scenario, going from this permutation to this one, you never observe an adjacency between 2 and 5 in the whole scenario. But you code this adjacency, you said 2 and 5, it's a zero somewhere here. And you have to do that for every pair of genes, even if you never see the adjacency. And this gives very long sequences with very many invariant zeros. So it's very difficult to estimate a real number of events if the sequences almost don't move, because you add a lot of stable sites. So one solution would be to get rid of all these zeros, so that the sequences are not seen as stable, and the movings are really seen. So let's say I erase in the sequence all the sites where you don't observe the adjacency at the beginning and don't observe the adjacency at the end. And this is what you get. So this time, the curve has a shape like this. So it's not much better. It has the opposite tendency. It overestimates a lot the inversion distance. And the explanation for this is that if you have a very small sequence, now you have a small sequence, and this sequence evolves 4 sites by 4 sites, because an inversion acts on 4 sites, then imagine on this sequence, you have one event, you get this sequence, and 2 events, you get this sequence. And now you apply a model where you are allowed to change only one site at each time, and you compare this sequence and this sequence, and the estimation of the real number of differences between the two won't be 2 events. It will be much higher, because most sites have changed. in only two events. So the estimated distance will be much larger than here, 8, for example, even if there are 8 differences and they are caused by only 2 events. So it's not a good way, it's not a good estimation to get rid of those zeros. But there is a way to do a correction to have a good estimate. So remember how to estimate the number of events in function of the number of different sites and the number of identical sites and the size of the sequence. So this is a standard binary model in which you are allowed to substitute one site at a time, and the estimation of the number of differences after a certain number of events, T is an event, is computed by computing here the probability of the number of differences at T plus 1 given the probability, given the number of differences at T, and the probability that it's plus 1 is a certain probability, and then you have your expectation. Now, if you model really the 4x4 evolution, that is, you have a probability that at T plus 1, the number of differences has increased by 4. You have a probability that it has increased by 2. You have a probability that it's unchanged. If you hit the sites that have already changed, it is unchanged. You have the probability that you have a reverse evolution decreasing the number of differences. You have a probability that it's decreased by 4. And by some computations, you arrive at a formula that is almost the same as before, with an estimation of the number of differences after a time t. The only difference is this factor 8. I just used the previous slide. There was a factor 2 here. There is a factor 8 here, which I call the 4x4 correction, which allows to make the correction of the number of events. So to estimate with a model that is very close to the 1x1 substitution, but giving this effect. So here is the curve of the simulation with 100 marker and everything. Everything is shown here. So there is inversion distance. There is when you add a lot of zero, when you get rid of all zeros, and here when you do the 4x4 corrections, which is equivalent to, in fact, doing something between this and this, which is adding a number of zeros, which is approximately 4 times the size of the sequence. And it's rather efficient because you can estimate the number of reversal approximately as well as an MCMC estimator or the MCMC estimator of Brett Larges. So you have a very much simpler space with only zeros and ones with which you can do phylogeny, and you arrive at results that are equivalent to results obtained by an MCMC on a permutation space. So there we are with gene tree, species tree, because with this 0-1 model of the evolution of adjacencies, now we can do more than comparing two genomes with a few number of genes, or going to maybe 10 genomes with a very few number of genes. We can scale to the phylogenetic methods that usually use models with local mutations, and mainly models with substitutions. So this is a drawing where genes evolve by gene trees inside a species tree, and genes have adjacencies between them. So these are close together and they evolve together. They can fuse and they can be transferred. They can duplicate. One can duplicate without the other duplicating. Here there is the two genes are adjacent and receive that transfers, etc. And adding the possibility of genes to be transferred, duplicated into the binary model, then you need propagation rule, evolution rules for the adjacencies. So here is a summary of the evolution propagation rules we use. So this is the tube of the species tree. These are the two lines for two gene trees, because for one adjacency you need two gene trees. And this is what can happen to the genes. And according to what happens to the genes, what happens to the adjacency? If one gene is lost, adjacency is lost also. If there is no event to the genes, you can follow, the adjacency can follow, and it can be also gained and lost. If one gene duplicates, the adjacency is transmitted to one of the two copies. If the two genes duplicate together, then the adjacencies is transferred to both copies. When there is a speciation, the adjacency speciates also, and it's possible that to include transfers, so that one gene is transferred or the two adjacent genes are transferred, and there are we can reconstruct like these groups of transferred genes. And we implemented that in two softwares called DECO and DECO LT. LT is for including lateral gene transfer, and what that these softwares do is computing the minimum number of gains and losses of adjacencies in a duplication and loss context, or in a duplication loss transfer and loss context. So if you have gene trees reconciled with species trees and reconciled with duplication and loss or duplication transfers and loss, then by dynamic programming you can still reconstruct the history of all adjacencies with minimizing the number of gains and losses. And gains and losses are the switches to zeros, from 0 to 1 and from 1 to 0, as I showed you before. You can use this software. In fact, I speak about adjacencies from the beginning, but now that an adjacency is just a link between two genes, adjacency, you can translate it into any relation between two genes. Suppose you have data about the interaction between two genes, or any kind of relation, regulation, proximity in the cell, etc. Then you can just use this framework to trace back the evolution of this relation, whether it was present or not in the ancestors, etc. And because in these softwares, ancestral genomes are not necessarily linearly organized. That is, one gene can have any number of neighbors. As you evolve the adjacencies independently one by one, it's not necessary that the ancestral genomes are linear. So to reconstruct the ancestral organization of chromosomes, this might seem a drawback of this method, but in fact it is not, because the nonlinearity may be due to many things, and not necessarily the errors in the reconstruction of the adjacencies, because there can be many errors before that. For example, it can be erroneous families, alignments, or trees, or reconciliations. Also, the adjacencies, of course, can be erroneous, but it can be also convergent evolution leading to erroneous adjacencies. This is the same kind of errors. And of course, it can be that the signal is lost. But as there are many causes to this nonlinearity, we can, for example, use this nonlinearity to reconstruct better gene trees. So let's try to see how much of this non-linearity is due to erroneous gene trees. So why can non-linearity be due to erroneous gene trees? Suppose there is a true gene tree here. The gene tree is there and the adjacencies are drawn with bold lines in violet bold lines here, and the gene tree is here with a duplication there. If the true story is that a duplication, then two speciations, and each ancestral genes has two neighbors, like in any bona fide chromosome. Let's say you make an error in reconstructing your gene tree, and instead of two ancestral genes, you reconstruct one because you place the duplications later. If you place the duplications later, then you have only one gene at a certain point, and the genes duplicate only later. But if you have only one gene, it has to take the two adjacencies from there and the two adjacencies from there. This makes four, and this makes this kind of pattern. For example, there are here genes with four neighbors. So probably there is an error in the gene tree there. It can be the converse. If the reality is that there is only one gene in an ancestral species with two neighbors, and you make an error in the gene tree, put the duplication to ancient, and infer two ancestral genes. Then you have two adjacencies that you have to share between the two, and you get the bad number of neighbors. Or, depending on the pattern of evolution, you get the two adjacencies for the for one gene, the two adjacencies for the other gene, but then you get non-linearity of the whole chromosome, as this neighbor has probably more than the two standard neighbors. So there are many reasons why the an erroneous gene tree can lead to non-linearity of ancestral chromosomes. So you can use the non-linearity to test the quality of your gene trees. And this is what we have done several times. This is some graphs Bastien and Gergay showed you before. It's a graph showing all ancestral genes with the number of their adjacencies, the number of their neighbors. So the ideal graph is this one, the one bottom right, with all ancestral genes having two neighbors. This makes linear ancestral chromosomes. So 100% two and 0% elsewhere. With phi-ML trees built from sequences, you get this kind of graph. With tree-based trees built from sequence and a bit of information from the species tree, you get the red graph, much closer to the ideal one. With field dog trees, Bastien has spoken a lot about field dogs, so I won't tell how it works again. Just saying that it models the evolution of genes with information from the sequences and from the species tree, and combines both models, and it gives something much closer than the two other methods to the ideal peak with two neighbors. So this means just changing the trees, you can have much more linear ancestral chromosomes. So in fact, it's good to have non-linear ancestral chromosomes because you can correct your old mistakes with the trees. And it's the same in a duplication, transfer, and loss context. Ancestral adjacencies here are reconstructed with DECO-LT, and if you construct your trees with phi-ML, this is what it gives. So something quite far from the... this is done with a mammalian dataset, and this is done with a cyanobacteria dataset. That is why here it's only in the duplication and loss context, and this is in the duplication, transfer, and loss context. And these, again, are the trees that are computed with sequence and species trees. So we have arguments to say that these trees are have a higher quality because they show higher degree of linearity in the ancestral chromosomes. Computing ancestral synthesis may be used as a measure of validity of the gene trees, but they can also be used to construct good gene trees. For example, this is what I did there to construct synteny blocks between extant species with an available software. Then, supposing that pairs of genes in the blocks are orthologs, and using also an available software, it's an article by Manuel Lafont, and I was a co-author of this paper, and the goal is to transform the trees. You start with some trees computed with here in this experiment, it was the trees from Ensemble, and we took the whole data set of trees from Ensemble, and we corrected them, forcing the pairs that are seen in synteny block to be orthologs. So we start from the trees and move the trees so that in the LCA reconciliation, in the duplication and loss model, the trees that are detected by synteny blocks are orthologs. And this makes much better trees. And we can see by the gene content here, this is a gene content of extant genomes, gene content of corrected ancestral genomes computed with corrected trees, and this is the ensemble trees. And again, the peak is much better with those trees corrected by synteny. Now, I drew again, there are many causes of nonlinearity of ancestral chromosomes, and I don't find a way to correct all these causes of nonlinearity. So at the end, there remains a bit of nonlinearity, and we can linearize them to reconstruct chromosomes that are as close as possible to the ancestral, what we think the ancestral chromosomes are. Once they are linearized, we can reconstruct the full sequence of ancestral chromosomes. And this is, for example, what we did with Cédric Chauve with the Yersinia pestis dataset. So there was a recently sequenced ancient genomes that was supposed to be at an ancestral state here on the phylogeny. It was the Yersinia pestis that was responsible for the Black Death in the Middle Ages. It was sequenced, but it was not assembled. And we use these techniques of reconstructed ancestral ancestral genomes with adjacencies to reconstruct the organization of the ancient chromosome and reconstruct the full sequence of it by reconstructing the ancestral sequence in the gaps in the adjacency also. So we could compare the ancient sequence, the full ancient sequence of the chromosome with some recent one, and show that there are many rearrangements. And it's surprising to see that even it's from the Middle Ages. So even if in a bit more than 500 years, there has been a lot of rearrangements. So this shows the extant chromosome, ancient chromosome, and the relations between them. There are many, many inversions. And some of these inversions create new genes. That's related to the very first simulation I showed you, that it might be a source of adaptation. And for example, I saw one gene that is in the extant sequence and is in a synteny breakpoint and is composed of a little part, two little parts of the ancestral sequence, but that are not contiguous here in the ancestral sequence, where they are contiguous and apparently form a gene in the extant sequence. That's it. This is a joint work with people from Budapest, from Vancouver, from Montreal, Montpellier, and from Lyon, including the two people you've already seen, Bastien and Gergely. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was a fantastic talk, very clear. If anybody has any questions, I hope you just go ahead and type them in the Q&A box. Maybe I'll start things off. I just had a couple questions. So there were a couple times you...
Sorry, I had been disconnected for some reason for a while. Sorry, I didn't hear your last sentences.
Okay. So a quick question. So how do you go... So when you do evolution, say, using this 4x4 model, how do you go from a series of adjacencies to a series of rearrangements? The number of rearrangements. I mean, there's some optimization process there, I guess.
You mean, yes, right. When I estimate the number of differences in adjacencies, how I compute the number of inversions, for example.
Exactly.
So I just, in this simulation, I just divide by 4. Because I suppose that every inversion hits 4 sides. So if I compute the number of different, I compute the number of different sides, then correct by this little correction, the 4x4 model, and then divide by 4 because I know that the real number of events is the, what I see divided by 4.
Okay.
So yes, in all these graphs, all values obtained from adjacencies are divided by 4. Mm-hmm.
So you said that deco and I think deco LT can really use any genomic features that can be sort of thought of as adjacencies.
Yes, I never tried that, but in theory it can, yes.
But but there's got to be some limitation. So in terms, like, not, I shouldn't say limitation, but there's got to be some criteria that would enable you to make such a dynamic program. I mean, so it's pretty much you have to have a model by which your adjacencies are sort of appear and disappear.
Yes.
As just a Markov process.
Yes, that's right. That's right. There is this model behind. The adjacencies indeed appear, disappear. It's a Markov process. And they are propagated. If the genes, if something happens to the genes, then they are propagated to the copies of the genes accordingly. So I imagine that, let's say, an interaction relation or participation to a complex of proteins. You could model also the gain and loss of this interaction according to if the products of the genes change enough so that an interaction is not possible anymore, or some new interaction is created because of some mutation, and so they can be gained, lost. But it's only a theoretical assessment because I really never tried that on data. I always try that on adjacencies. So all what I can show you is on adjacencies. And if, but yeah, it's a lack of data also. Data for adjacencies are available, but interactions for many species like this, it's harder to find. But if somebody wants to try, it would be nice.
Well, so you know there's this, I mean, so there's adjacencies in terms of the linear genome, but then you can also think about adjacencies in terms of the folded genome that people have been assessing with Hi-C. So, I mean, they've postulated that there are, you know, reasons why certain genes fold up next to other genes.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I guess in principle you could reconstruct the adjacencies in the 3D structure.
Yeah, right. So as we get more and more informations about this position of the relative position of genes in the cell and if they are evolutionary conserved or not, then we could do something with that, yes.
I just have one more. This is probably sort of not very well-formed question, but I feel a little bit like one should be able to almost ignore the creation of adjacencies and just think about the breaking of adjacencies. Maybe I should just stop there. But it seems like, I mean, you have this setup by which you, I mean, like you say, the adjacency data is on a relatively short time scale. And there's clearly some adjacencies that need to be broken up. It seems like the complication really comes from the, like, creation of the adjacencies rather than just modeling their breaking.
Yes, maybe.
I don't know.
So, in fact, this gain and loss thing is really inspired by the substitution between 0 and 1, the presence-absence thing. So when I thought about presence-absence, it was quite natural for me to think of a model where you could switch from presence to absence and from absence to presence. So you would propose to simplify things and just detect the breakages. Yes. Yeah. Okay. I don't know. I didn't try that.
Yeah. Like I say, it's not a very well formed thought. But yeah, it seems like that would sort of be more amenable to large scale sort of Markov modeling or something like that. Anyway, that's all the questions I have. Is that work, the 4x4 work, published yet?
Which one?
The 4x4.
No, the 4x4, no, it's not published. It's something we are currently doing with Laurent Guéguin and a PhD student of us, Magali Semeria, but no, the 4x4 correction is not published.
Yeah, I look forward to that. I mean, that seems like a very good way to go. Cool. Thanks. All right, well, thank you very much. Much appreciate
thank you.
Your talk, and
thank you for
Yeah, you're welcome. All right, well, we don't have a next seminar scheduled, but you'll be able to follow along on phyloseminar.org.